what we try to get at is, where is it that that particular writer discovers his or her creativity? You know, what is it that they do with this thing called life to make it into another creative element, whether it be a novel or poetry or even a personal essay? You know, how do they take something that happens to them and make it into a piece of art?
The thing about literature is it wasn't a written tradition, particularly poetry. It was a spoken tradition. And that's the way culture was passed on from one generation to the next. Poetry is rhymed, so it's easier to remember and to be passed on. And that's the way culture is passed on. The New Letters tapes are no different than that. They represent the American culture. All those Pulitzer Prize winning authors reading their own works, it's an invaluable collection.
And I had a call the other day from a man who had heard a show that we did, and he told me, you know, he said he was going to be turning 77 in the next week, and that he didn't know how much time he had left, but what I do enriches his life every week. You know, and I feel like that is important. We kind of lose sight of that during our day-to-day work here, but it is important to me to know that we are enriching people's lives with the work that we do.
This is the third time I've had the good fortune to visit Kansas City, and on each occasion I've got to meet with Angela, and it's a bit like, you know, if you lived in ancient Greece, you went to Delphi to sort of, you know, get in touch with the kind of spirit of the universe. And you know, I think of coming to Kansas City as a way to get in touch with what's going on in writing, with the best side of writing.
I wasn't one of the founders, but I assisted the people who founded it, David and Judy Ray. And then for many years after that, I worked with James McKinley here at New Letters, who sustained the radio program over 18, 20, 25-year span. I myself have conducted radio interviews, and so I have a great long-term stake in the radio program, not only in its existence but in its advancement.
New Letters on the Air received a Save America's Treasures grant from the National Endowment for the Arts. It was in a partnership with the National Endowment for the Arts, the National Park Service, the White House, and a bunch of other different governmental organizations.
We had to get matching funds for this particular grant, and that was the hard part, is that we had to do, is from the moment we found out on December 17th until the grant match was due on February 28th, we really had to push to get the matching funds. So that took some doing, and it was great that we got a good response from listeners, from people in our community, and from writers.
I've always aspired to write those kinds of novels, which have big, ambitious plots and lots of characters coming and going, but yet at the same time a very clear sense of the architecture of the novel and where the novel is going.
Writing is so risky to start with. You might spend 3 years pecking away at a book and accomplish no more than if you had sat watching TV and eating Cheez-Its. So you cherish your freedom, the thing that makes writing fun, the chance to irritate and enrage.
Our reel-to-reel tapes have been improperly stored over the years. They've been stored in this office back before it had, you know, air conditioning, and so it was subject to a lot of heat and cold temperature extremes.
I personally have been worried about our reel-to-reel tapes for a while because they only last, I mean, it's been a great medium over the years. You know, it was invented in World War II and has lasted for a long time. But with reel-to-reel tape, you have to exercise it regularly, which means just running it through something.
Here at the Marr Sound Archives, and this is something we've been talking about for a long time, we're working with New Letters on the Air to preserve their recorded legacy, both the raw interviews and the produced programs, and we're preserving those by re-recording them and to digital files, and also we're going to make them available to the public by making copies available through the Miller Nichols Library. They will be cataloged and available just as any book is available in the library. So they're available not only to and through their work, they can make them available internationally, because once they're digitized, it'll be easy to distribute them through the web for New Letters on the Air. And also, we hope to establish an ongoing program to continue preserving their legacy and to make them available.
One of the frustrations of experiencing Angela's interviews was not being able to recommend them to students or share them with friends because they weren't widely available. And so it's great from the point of view of my teaching and my, you know, work in libraries and schools to say, here's a place you can go to hear authors talking in a way that's it's not too stuffy and academic, it's more informal, and it's something that the lay reader, if that's the right term, can really appreciate. And I think Angela brings an extraordinary warmth and intelligence to her interviews that is really rare. And so, I mean, I think it's very important to say she is one of the treasures being archived.
It's a very significant collection, and there's over 700 tapes. A lot of these authors are no longer with us. In some instances, it's the only recording of their voice. For example, Milton Mamembe Smith, who's a local poet, an African American, it's the only tape ever made of him reading his own works. And he was a very important figure here locally as well as nationally among African American writers. Think about all the Native Americans that are on those tapes too, and all the women, and all the voices that have since been silenced will live on through these tapes.
I think a big part of the mission of New Letters that is now being expanded as you build the archive and digitalize the contents is that mission of reaching new readers, new generations of readers. And that's a wonderful and happy thing.
New Letters on the Air really is the long-term product of a lot of people. And I mentioned David Ray and Judy Ray. I should mention Rebecca Presson, who was the producer for many years, and James McKinley as well. And people who really have worked hard, oftentimes on a volunteer level, to sustain this radio program over the years. And really, it's that legacy that we bring forward into the archive project.
It is a joy. I spend so much time working on these interviews that I am glad that they're being saved, mainly because I try to show who that writer is and what their themes are, what they're trying to do with their work. And ideally, I try to get something new out of each writer that comes here. I'm hoping to open up something that he or she may not have even thought about. And I'll get that response occasionally from people. I'm trying to do something that's a little bit different so that it can add to their representation out there as artists. You know what it is? I try to get out of the way in doing this and let the writer shine.